Okay, hello everyone to today's seminar. It is my great pleasure to introduce Pierre-Jean Meyer today. Pierre-Jean Meyer received his PhD degree in automatic control in Grenoble in 2015. Afterwards, he did several international research stays as a postdoc researcher, partially in Sweden at the KTH, and is also at the Berkeley University in the USA. And since a few months, he's now back in France at the Université Gustave Eiffel à Lille. And yes, I think it's more or less a continuation of his work. He is mostly related his research activities to interval methods in reachability analysis. And that's also the area where today's talk will come from. Pierre-Jean, the floor is yours now.
Thanks a lot. So yeah, I'm going to be talking about interval reachability analysis, which cover most of the work I've been doing during my previous postdoc at UC Berkeley. So first, let's define what I mean by interval reachability analysis. We are given a system, either a discrete time system x plus equal f of x, or a continuous time system x dot equal f of x. We have an interval of initial states, here the gray box, and we want to evaluate this blue set of all the states that are reachable by the system from the gray box in a given time. So either one discrete time step for discrete time system or a specific time for a continuous time system. And just to clarify, for continuous time system, we don't care about the whole reachable tube for the whole time range. We only want to evaluate the final reachable set, so at the final time of the time range. And since for our system, we cannot evaluate this set exactly, we rely on creating an over approximation in the form of a multidimensional interval like this red box here. So why are we using intervals? There are a lot of other choices of set representation, but interval is one of the simplest ones. So it induces some weakness, which means that because it's so simple as a set representation, we don't have that much flexibility to approximate the reachable set, so we might not have very good accuracy. But it has also a lot of strength. For the simplicity to define, to manipulate, and to store for the implementation, because any interval, whatever the dimension of the state space, will be defined by just two state vectors, one for the lower bound and one for the upper bound. For reachability analysis, most of the methods using intervals are also very low complexity and very good scalability. And in some applications, it's also useful that intervals are closed under intersection, which is not the case of most other set representations. So why are we doing reachability analysis? In this slide, I mentioned three possible applications in which it comes into play. It's obviously not exhaustive, but in the case of verification of safety and reachability specification, we could use this reachability analysis to check, does this interval over approximation intersect a set of unsafe states? And if not, we know that the system is safe, for sure. For reachability specification, we check if the over approximation is fully contained in a target set, and if yes, we know that we satisfy the specification. For more complicated specifications, such as linear temporal logic formulas, we can also rely on abstraction-based control synthesis, where we would partition the state space, with each partition being an interval. From each of these partition elements, we would use this reachability analysis to over-approximate the behavior of the continuous system and abstract the whole continuous system into a finite transition system. And then on this final transition system, we can use model checking method to synthesize a controller. And in this type of application, having a reachability analysis with very low complexity is very important because we have several millions of reachable sets to compute. And the closeness under intersection of the interval is also very interesting for this type of method. The third type of application that we can consider for reachability analysis is to have some kind of measure of the robustness for a controller of a given system. So for that, we will be using the volume of the reachable set over approximation under some bounded disturbance or bounded uncertainty to evaluate, to use this volume to give some kind of measure of the robustness. So, in this talk, the goal would be to give you an overview of several different methods for interval reachability analysis. And I'm going to focus on a tutorial-like presentation where I'm going to present the intuition for each method, what are the requirements and limitations, and how do we actually use the method? So how do we actually compute the over approximation? And I might not go into too much of the technical detail and mathematical proof for that. I'm going to give an overview of these six methods, which cover both discrete time and continuous time systems. This list is not exhaustive of all the interval reachability analysis method, of course. It's just a few a sample of it. It focuses on three class of methods, the one that are based on the monotonicity property or its extension into mixed monotonicity, the one that are based on obtaining some kind of bound on the growth or contraction between any two pair of trajectory of the system, and the last category is sampling-based approach. And I will finish the talk with an overview of the MATLAB toolbox TIRA, which includes an implementation of most of the methods that I'm going to present today. So the first method I'm going to talk about is based on monotonicity. To give an intuition of this method, I'm going to consider a particular case of monotone system, which are called cooperative systems, where the discrete time system is said to be cooperative if its vector field preserves the component-wise inequality. That means that if x is greater than x hat, then the successor f of x will be greater than f of x hat on each dimension. And that kind of result is very useful for reachability analysis because any initial state in this gray interval is greater than x underline and smaller than x overline, which means that the true reachable set here in blue is necessarily contained in this red interval obtained by the successor of x underline and the successor of x overline. So we have a method that has very low complexity because we just need to compute two successors of the system, even if we are in a high dimension. And we are also guaranteed to have a tight interval over approximation. That is, it's the smallest interval that fully contains the reachable set. So this was for the particular case of cooperative system. For the more general case of monotone system, we replace this component-wise inequality by more general partial order. And the result for the reachability method will just be that instead of obtaining this red interval based on the successor of the lower and upper bound of the initial interval, it will be another pair of vertices in the initial interval, which will depend on the partial order that we define. So more formally, the requirement for a system to be monotone or for to apply this monotonicity-based approach is that we need the Jacobian function to be sign stable. So each element of the Jacobian is either always positive for all initial state x or always negative for all x. And on top of that, we need a specific sign structure for the Jacobian matrix which would be defined by this Boolean vector epsilon. So we have one epsilon I for each dimension of the state. And once we have once we satisfy this assumption and we know this epsilon, we can use it to define what would be the two initial states, the two vertices of the initial interval that define the lower bound and upper bound of the overall approximation. So for the lower bound, we would take the lower bound xi if epsilon I is zero, and the upper bound xi if epsilon I is one. Just to clarify on the actual result of the interval of our approximation, yeah, I define it as an interval, but it's a bit of an abuse of notation. When we are not cooperative, this first evaluation of the system is not smaller with the component-wise inequality than this one. It's just that they define two bounds of the interval that can help us create this, this interval. So again, this method, we get an over-approximation with very low complexity, just two evaluations of the system, and it's always guaranteed to be tight over-approximation. An example to explain what I meant with this two lower and upper bound, which are not according to the component-wise inequality. If we take this Jacobian, this sign structure for the Jacobian, plus minus on the first row and minus plus on the second row, it satisfies the assumption from the previous slide with epsilon in 0 and 1. That means that this lower bound of the result is obtained from the state using the lower bound of x1 and the upper bound of x2. So that's this orange state, which is here on the top left corner of the interval. And the upper bound in purple would be the vertex that is diagonally opposite on the interval. So I presented that in the case of a discrete time system, we have the same method for continuous time system with just a few differences. For the requirement, this sign structure of the Jacobian needs to be satisfied not just for all initial states, but needs to be satisfied on an invariant set X that we need to find. So that can be sometimes a problem for continuous time system. The second difference is that the sign structure is the same, except we don't have any condition on the diagonal of the Jacobian. We just don't care at all about it. And the final result is pretty much the same. We just replace the evaluation of the vector field by the evaluation of the successor of the continuous time system at the final time big T. Now, this monatomicity approach is very nice and very efficient, but it's restricted to this class of monotone system. So the next method, based on mixed monotonicity, aims at applying similar approach, but to systems that are not monotone. So we say that a discrete time system is mixed monotone if we can find the decomposition function G, which has twice as many input arguments as the vector field F. G needs to be increasing in the first argument and decreasing in the second argument. And F needs to be embedded on the diagonal of G. So G of X and X is equal to F of X. And with that, we can again compute an interval over approximation of the reachable set with just two evaluations of the decomposition function G. The drawback is that we don't have tightness guarantee anymore. So to apply this method, the main assumption is formulated in this box, where we need the existence of a constant matrix L, such that for each dimension, for each element of the Jacobian plus Lij is either always positive or always negative. And with this formulation, it looks a bit complicated, but it's actually a very simple assumption. All it says is that we need the Jacobian matrix to be, well, each element of the Jacobian matrix to be either lower bounded or upper bounded. It doesn't even need to be bounded on both sides. As long as it's bounded on one side, we will be able to compute this matrix F. Another interesting thing is that any Lipschitz continuous vector field would satisfy this assumption. So most systems are mixed momentum. In the method, we also provide the constructive definition of the decomposition function G, where for each dimension of the state I, we have Gi of x and x hat, which is an evaluation of the vector field Fi at the state Xi, which is defined based on the element xj or x at j, depending on the sign from the corresponding Jacobian element in the assumption. And then we have an error term, which is the rho I of matrix L in absolute value times x minus x hat. And with that, we have this over approximation result where the reachable set is contained in the interval defined by g of x underline x overline and g of x overline x underline. So again, we have a very low complexity and very good scalability because for any dimension, we obtain this interval over approximation just with two evaluations of g. In terms of tightness, we don't have the guarantee of tightness all the time, but we have this guarantee when we know the Jacobian is sign stable, that is when the constant matrix L is a zero matrix. And another interesting point is that when a system is monotone, applying this mixed monotonicity approach will result in the same method as in the same result as the monotonicity method. To illustrate how the over approximation works, if we take this sign structure for the Jacobian plus L being plus plus and minus plus, with L being zero everywhere except for L 1 2, which is positive, we can reason on each dimension. For the first dimension, we have the lower bound of the over approximation, which is evaluation F1 of state, the blue state C1. So this state is defined by the sign of the first row of the Jacobian, of the sign structure. So since we have two plus sign, the lower bound is obtained with lower bound of both X1 and X2. And the upper bound in green is the true upper bound as well. And because L is non-zero on this first row, we have this plus minus error term of L12 times x2 overline minus x2 underline. On the second dimension, we do the same, where the lower bound of the interval would be the evaluation F2 of C2, which now, because of the sign of the second row minus and plus, we would have the upper bound of X1 and the lower bound of X2. So that's a purple state. And for the upper bound, we would have the diagonally opposite vertex. And because L is zero on its second row, we don't have an error term here, so we are tight only on the second dimension. Again, for continuous time system, we have a very similar approach with also similar difference as in the monotonicity case. For the assumption, we have no condition on the diagonal of the Jacobian, and the sign condition needs to be satisfied on an invariant set X instead of just initial interval. The decomposition function G will have the same definition as in the discrete case, but because we can't obtain an over approximation just with evaluation of the vector field anymore for continuous time system, we need to define this embedding system with vector field H defined by g of x, x hat and g of x hat x. And then the over approximation of the continuous time reachable set would be from just one evaluation of the successor of H with initial state X underline, X overline, where we take the first n component to define the lower bound and the last n component to define the upper bound. Now, the third method that I'm going to present comes from what I pointed out, that in the case of mixed monotonicity, we have a guaranteed tightness in the discrete time case when the Jacobian is sign stable. But we don't have this guarantee in the continuous time case. So we wanted to find a method that works for continuous time system and that would be able to give similar guarantee as in the discrete time method. So in order to do that, we will apply the discrete time approach to the sample data version of the continuous time system. So with defining as a discrete time system for the time big T. So for the discrete time mixed monotonicity approach, we had a requirement of a bounded Jacobian matrix. For the sample data version, it would translate into having a bounded sensitivity matrix, which is the partial derivative of the successor at time big T with respect to initial condition. And the main challenge in this approach would be to be able to bound this sensitivity matrix, because unlike the vector field of discrete time system where we have a closed form expression, for the trajectory of the continuous time system, we don't have a closed form function. So I'm going to give an overview of three different approaches to obtain this sensitivity bound. The first one is based on interval analysis. The assumption of the method is to have bounds on the Jacobian matrix of the continuous time system. And the method itself will be studying the linear system describing the variation of the sensitivity matrix. So the time derivative of S of the sensitivity is the Jacobian function along the trajectory of the system times the sensitivity. And it's initialized with identity matrix. So we know that the sensitivity at the final time big T is contained in this interval matrix exponential. And what we do is create a Taylor over approximation of this interval matrix exponential using this paper from Matthias Althoff using interval analysis. So this is a method that is sound. We have a guaranteed over approximation of the sensitivity bounds. It is fast in most cases, but it's usually very conservative to the point that it's not very usable in practice. So the second method is a bit the opposite of the first. Here we don't have any assumption. It's based on sampling and falsification. The first step is we take some sample initial state in the initial interval. It can be a grid sampling or random samples. We evaluate the final sensitivity for each of these samples, and we take the interval L of all these sensitivity values. Because it's just based on sampling, it's not a guaranteed over approximation of the state of the set of sensitivity values. So the second step is the falsification approach, where we would define an optimization problem to find initial states whose evaluation of the sensitivity does not belong to this sensitivity bound that we obtained previously. If we find one, we will update the sensitivity bounds and we repeat this falsification until we don't find anymore. The problem is this falsification does not guarantee either that we would obtain an over approximation. It improves the bound, but it's still not sound. However, it usually gives a much better, a much closer approximation of the true set of sensitivity values. The last method is a bit in between the previous two, being able to tune the complexity of the sampling approach and the conservativeness of the interval analysis method. So this one also relies on the second order Jacobian matrix, which is a partial order partial derivative of the first order Jacobian with respect to x. And the second order sensitivity is also the derivative of the first order sensitivity with respect to initial condition. Here again, with the chain rule, we can define the affine system describing the second order sensitivity as the first order Jacobian times the second order sensitivity plus the second order Jacobian times this Kronecker product of the first order sensitivity. And initial conditions are the zero matrix. The assumption for this method is that both the first order and second order Jacobian matrices are bounded. And then we have three steps to the method. The first one is we reuse the interval analysis result from the Althoff paper that I mentioned before on the first order sensitivity system to approximate the set of all possible sensitivity value over the whole time range. So it's a reachability tube here. We'll use this reachability tube in the second step to combine it with the interval analysis method again on the system for the second order sensitivity to approximate the final set of second order sensitivity values. And the last step, we will again use sampling of the interval, the initial interval, and evaluation of the first order sensitivity for each of these samples. But by combining it with bounds of the second order sensitivity, we obtain a guaranteed over approximation of the first order sensitivity at the final time. And the granularity of the sampling grid will be what we can use to tune this trade-off between complexity and conservativeness. Just to summarize the strengths and weakness of each of these three methods, for the interval analysis, we have a guaranteed over approximation, usually with low complexity, but we are very conservative. For the sampling and falsification, we have no requirement and usually very accurate approximation, but it's not sound, it's not an over approximation. And because it's based on sampling, it's very high in terms of complexity. And the last approach is sound, and both the complexity and conservativeness are tunable, but we have additional requirement on bounding the second order Jacobian. Okay, so the fourth approach that I'm going to present is based on gross bound for continuous time system. So this type of method appears in the literature in, under various terms, gross bounds, as I mentioned, contraction analysis, incremental stability, discrepancy function. Basically, all of these are similar methods that describe the exponential convergence or divergence of any pair of trajectories of the system. So in the case of contraction, the trajectory would converge toward each other, and in the case of growth, diverge from each other. So in this section, I'm going to just refer to that as growth and to encapsulate also the case of negative growth corresponding to contraction. And here, the intuition is that if we can obtain an upper bound on this growth rate C, even if the growth rate is negative, we would be able to do the reachability analysis very easily. So for that, the assumption is that on some invariant set of the state space, there exists a scalar C, which would be our gross bound, which is an upper bound of the infinity matrix measure of the Jacobian. That is, for each row of the Jacobian, row I, with some the diagonal element and the absolute value of all the non-diagonal elements. And then we take the max on all the row of the Jacobian. Once we have this gross bound C, the over approximation is obtained by taking the center of the initial interval, x star. We evaluate its successor after time dt, which is this red dot here. And then we will create an interval around this successor, which is plus and minus exponential of C times t, and you multiply this exponential by the half root of the initial interval. So this method also has a very low complexity, similar to the monotonicity approach, because we just compute one successor of the continuous time system. So it has, very good scalability. But in this method, we don't have any guarantees of tightness in any specific condition. There is an alternative method where instead of defining a scalar growth bound, you could define a matrix bound where matrix C would be greater than the diagonal of the Jacobian and greater of than the absolute value of the non-diagonal element of the Jacobian. And with that, the method is exactly the same, except this exponential will become a matrix exponential. So having a growth bound on each dimension helps us get something more accurate, so less conservative, but the computation of the matrix interval, matrix exponential will increase a little bit the computation time. And there is a third approach, which is a bit in between, or rather is a generalization of both the methods that I presented, where instead of defining a scalar bound on the whole Jacobian or a matrix bound on each bounding each element of the Jacobian, we take a partition, a block partition of the Jacobian matrix, and obtain a scalar bound of each block of the Jacobian. So that way, we have more way to tune the trade-off between complexity and conservativeness. The next method is based on quasi-Monte Carlo, which can be seen as a generalization of this growth bound approach, but to a grid sampling. So in the growth bound approach that I just presented, we have a unit sample in the center of the initial interval, and we consider the growth here in red, depending on the half width of the whole initial interval. If now, for the quasi-Monte Carlo, we take a uniform grid inside the initial interval and compute the successor of each of these sample points, we can apply the growth bound method for each from each of these points, but not with the half width of the whole interval, but with the half width of the grid size. So this is in blue, this A. So we can create this nine pink intervals, and then take which, so the union of these nine pink intervals is guaranteed to contain, to be an over approximation of the true reachable set. But because we want just interval over approximation and not a union of interval, we can take the interval L of all these smaller intervals. So for the method itself, in the case of continuous time system, the requirement is that we have some kind of scalar growth bound as in the previous method. And we have defined a uniform sampling grid with size 2a. So the size between two samples is 2 times a. And the result would have pretty much the same form as a result for the growth bound, except the evaluation of the samples would become the interval L of all the samples of the grid. And then we have the plus or minus the growth bound, but which does not define, which is not defined based on the half width of the initial interval, but just the half width of the grid of the sample. So this is the parameter A. So that way we have a way to tune this precision and complexity. This method also works for discrete time system. Now, the last method that I'm going to present is based on Monte Carlo, and it's very different from all the ones that I presented before, because here we are not focusing on soundness, on getting an over approximation. This is a random approach with some probabilistic objective. So what we do is we take some random sampling in the initial interval, evaluate the successor for all these samples and take the interval L of these samples. So that's our interval over approximation. And the goal here will be this nested probabilistic objective with one objective on accuracy with parameter epsilon, where we want that a random initial state would yield a successor that has a high probability of being in the interval approximation, so with probability higher than 1 minus epsilon. And the second objective is on confidence with parameter delta, where we want to have a probability greater than 1 minus delta that this interval approximation has satisfied this accuracy probability. So that's why these two objectives are nested into each other. So in summary, we want high confidence that approximation has high accuracy. And the goal here is to find how many samples, big N, are needed to achieve these two probabilities. So more formally, this method has no specific assumption, and it works for both continuous time and discrete time system. I'm going to present it in the case of continuous time notations. We just take a set of random samples of n random samples in the initial interval. And the main result is that if the number of samples n satisfies this, is equal to this value, where this bracket has the ceiling operator, then we satisfy this nested probability. That means that we have 1 minus delta confidence that this interval over approximation, this interval L, is at least 1 minus epsilon accurate. And some nice thing to notice in terms of complexity is that the number of samples needed is only linear in the dimension small n of the state space. So we have much lower complexity than the quasi Monte Carlo approach, which was based on a grid of the state space. So quasi Monte Carlo had the exponential complexity. We can also notice that the complexity is in terms of 1 over epsilon for the accuracy and log of 1 over delta for the confidence, which means that increasing the confidence is much cheaper in terms of complexity than increasing the accuracy. And again, I want to emphasize the fact that this method is not sound. It doesn't provide guaranteed over approximations. A last slide just to emphasize this, the meaning of these nested probabilities on an example. If we consider a system in dimension 5 and a desired epsilon being 0.05 and delta 0.01, then if we take 463 random samples, we would have 99 confidence, which is this 1 minus delta, 99% chance that this red interval over approximation is contain 95% of the reachable set. So this 99 is the confidence and 95 is the accuracy. Now, a few words on a system with inputs or time-varying vector fields. In all the methods that I presented, both for discrete time system and continuous time system, all of them can handle a time-varying vector field. All of them also can handle having an input in the vector field, but some have some limitations. In particular, we have two limitations. The first one is for continuous time system. Some of the methods need the input signal to be constant over the considered time range for the reachability analysis. That's the case of the sample data with monotonicity, because we cannot define the partial derivative, the sensitivity with respect to an input signal. So we need an input value only. For the quasi Monte Carlo, also, it's because when we take a grid partition of the input space, of the input interval, we can't allow anymore the variation of the input on the whole range of values. And finally, for the Monte Carlo method, it's also because it gets tricky to define probability distribution with respect to input signals. So that's why we only take input constant input values. The second limitation is for the gross bound method. We need the system description to be with additive input, so in the form of x dot equal f of t and x plus p. So now a few words on the MATLAB toolbox TIRA, which stands for Toolbox for Interval Reachability Analysis, that we have created and published about 2 years ago. The main design objective when we created the toolbox were first to create a library of various interval reachability methods within a unified framework, have something that is easily extensible with a new method, either by us or by other users. And finally, we want something that is usable easily by non-expert user of reachability analysis or interval reachability analysis. So all these objectives were met by the design choice of the architecture of the toolbox, where we define each reachability method in its own separate function. And then we have a big hub function, which takes as input the system description and the definition of the reachability problem, as well as optionally the choice of which method to apply. And then it will check if the corresponding method can be applied and call it and return the corresponding result. So that way we do provide a unified framework for all these methods. It is very easy to extend because we just define a new method in a separate file and add the call of the method and checking the requirement of the method in this hub function. And lastly, it's easier to use for non-expert user because the choice of the method is an optional argument. So if you don't choose which method to use, this hub function will actually go through the requirements of each method one by one and apply the first method whose requirements are satisfied. Another point on usability by a non-expert user is that method based on interval, reachability method based on interval are very simple because there is almost no internal parameter for the reachability solver. That way, someone who doesn't know the specific method or doesn't know much reachability analysis might use this toolbox without needing to know the detail of how to apply each specific method or to know how to decide which method to use. So the method currently implemented in the public version of the toolbox are here in red. So the method based on monotonicity, mixed monotonicity for the three version of discrete time, continuous time, and the sample data version of continuous time system. And we have the gross bound approach. And right now we are working on adding a few more methods. First method to obtain the sensitivity bounds with a tunable trade-off based on second order sensitivity. And adding both the quasi Monte Carlo and Monte Carlo methods. So this should appear on the toolbox website probably in the coming months. We are polishing the final implementation. So a few words of conclusion. In this talk, I presented an overview of various methods for interval reachability analysis, which each have their own strengths and weakness and should be used depending on what are your objectives and how you define the performance that you want to reach. Is it generality? Is it something that is broadly applicable? Low complexity? Do you want tightness, which with soundness, or with over approximation, or just accuracy, but without soundness? And of course, the list of methods that I presented is far from exhaustive. I just focused on the method that appeared in the book Interval Reachability Analysis that we recently published in January with Alex Davenport and Murat Archak. And also on the methods that are implemented in the MATLAB toolbox Jira, which you can find in this on this GitLab page. So if you are interested in the toolbox or in the book, or if you have any question about that, feel free to contact me on this email address.
So many thanks, Pierre-Jean, for your very interesting presentation. And yes, your talk is now open for discussion. Who wants to start with questions? Yes, Luc, please go ahead.
Yes, okay. Thank you, Pierre-Jean, for this talk. I have a question. You hear me, yes?
Yes.
Yeah. About your Monte Carlo method or quasi-Monte Carlo method, why do you sample, why your grid, you take your grid on all the box and not only on the boundary of the box?
So for the...
In the continuous case, of course.
Yes. So for the quasi Monte Carlo method, the goal is basically to use this gross bound method, but by partitioning the initial interval in smaller bounds. So we take this partition. So this grid actually defines the partition where we split between the samples.
Yes.
And we use the gross bound method for each of these elements. So the small square around this sample, then the small square around this sample. Yes. So this is necessary to...
Yes, but you take your point not only in the border.
No, actually we don't have any point on the border. This X underline and overline are just here to define the interval, but they are not sample points.
Yes, but you could take the sampling, the grid, only on the border, probably, because your function that gives you the state at time capital T, this function is will be invertible. So probably the boundary will remain. I think it would be sufficient to take the gridding only on the boundary, but maybe I'm wrong.
I'm not sure, because I think the main problem is this, what is represented in blue here. Is when you define the, when you evaluated the successor of one sample, in order to over approximate over this sample, this gross bound is based on the parameter A, which is the distance between two samples in this grid. If you only sample on the boundary, the distance, the maximal distance between two samples would be basically the whole interval. So we would still have many samples, but we would have much larger box around each sample. So I think the uniform grid is the way to get this dispersion of the sampling to be the smallest possible.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, do we have any further questions? Okay, before further questions arise, maybe two comments from my side and also a few questions. One thing that I liked very much around slide number, I think it was slide number 9, where you presented the mixed monotonicity. I think this is a very interesting formulation of something investigated, I think, around 100 years ago by Max Müller in a German publication. I'm not sure if you know this paper, where he also investigated monotonicity properties of ODEs, yes, something around 100 years ago. I think it was in 1927.
Okay.
Yes, and I really very much like this formulation here. Yes, and the other thing is concerning your toolbox. Do you implement the basic functionalities of interval analysis yourself in the toolbox, or does your toolbox rely on something else like IntLab or whatever as some core functionality?
No, so right now, as I mentioned in the sample data mixed monotonicity approach, to compute the sensitivity bound, we rely on some interval analysis method. So we decided to just re-implement the interval arithmetic operator and the way to over approximate this this interval matrix exponential. That way it's fully self-contained in the toolbox and we don't need to rely on external tools.
Okay, and since I still do not see anyone who has raised their hand, let me continue with a little bit of questions. The thing that you described in slide 20, if you could open this, reminds me of a stability analysis using Gershgorin's circle criterion. And I think it's very very promising to use this technique in cases where you can prove in advance that your system model is asymptotically stable. Because then I think you can expect to get also contracting tubes for stable dynamic systems. And did you investigate something maybe in between this full matrix C that you had shown here and the scalar parameter, let's say something to use different growth rates on a diagonal on the matrix C, because this is something I investigated a few years ago, independent growth rates that were computed using something like a Picard iteration. Yes, this method had also a drawback. It fails to compute tubes when the steady state, when the equilibrium is included in the box, because then the Picard iteration doesn't converge. But I think that's something that is nicely in between the two formulations using the full matrix C and a scalar parameter.
Yeah, so I haven't studied what you are describing, especially not anything on the diagonal. I know, so these are on this method and growth bound are not my results. They are mostly taken from the literature. But what you are describing on something in between having a full matrix and having a scalar, this has been studied by two separate groups, the group of Murat Artsakh a few years ago, which was also doing this block partition of the Jacobian. And then on each block of the Jacobian, we get a scalar bound using this infinity matrix measure.
Yes, and in my case, it was something like getting a scalar bound for each row of the function f. I get a scalar bound for f1, for f2, and so on.
Okay. Yeah, no, it's the only thing I know is on a block partition of the Jacobian, so it's not on separating per row.
But yeah, yes. I'll forward you the link to this to the paper after the presentation.
But yes, there is another group that worked on something similar that what I just described with this block partition, which was the Polish group, I think with Tomasz Capella. So which was also a similar result. So.
Okay, now do we have further questions from the audience? No questions from the audience, no question in the chat. Okay, I still have a further question. The further question is something maybe in between the methods you presented for monotonicity and mixed monotonicity. Because what you could investigate is to try to find a change of coordinates that transforms more or less an arbitrary function f into something that is either monotonic or at least mixed monotonic. Is this a plan to include also in the toolbox in future work?
So that's not something I have considered. There are a few things. I know there is a recent paper by the group of Sam Coogan in Georgia Tech that considered this problem of using change of variable and combining it with mixed monotonicity to get tighter over approximation. So in the state space of the initial system, it wouldn't be interval anymore because there is some rotation and possibly deformation. But the idea is to still to apply the mixed motility approach after doing the transformation, the change of variable. There is another thing that we can mention about the monotonicity case. What I presented here, this is a very special case of cooperative system with component-wise inequalities. And a more general case is using more general partial orders. So instead of having all this greater being greater on each element, it could be greater on the first one, smaller on the second one, and so on. So this partial order are defined by different orthogonal of the state space. But the real definition, the most general definition of monotonicity is with any type of partial order that are defined based on a cone of the state space. In practice, I haven't seen it be used much in reachability analysis because we can't use anymore classical inequalities and so on, but there might be ways with that to do this change of variable from this general monotone function with respect to a cone to bring them back to a more classical inequality.
Yes, I think maybe the reason why this is not so much used is a problem of modeling the systems, because I think you should directly detect the monotonicity properties during modeling or derive your system model in such a way that you can see the monotonicity. And that, at least for, let's say, high dimensional physical systems, that's really critical to figure out.
Yeah, especially in the next slide. This condition on the sign of the Jacobian is only in this particular case where the partial order is defined by either greater than or smaller than on each dimension. If you define it with a more general partial order, this assumption is not a sufficient condition for the, for the monotonicity.
Yes, and maybe, if I'm just already asking questions, let's go to the slide 26. There's one thing I do not fully agree, or maybe you expressed it a little bit too harshly. The last bullet point that you have here, you said it's something like a drawback, some kind of limitation here, this form. And I'm not really sure if this is a drawback, because let's say you have something like an electrical system, electromechanical system, or electromagnetic system. Usually your state equations in the continuous time case, they have this input affine structure. You can split up directly the state equations into a form that is purely state dependent, this function f, plus something that is input dependent. And let's say for 99% of electromechanical systems, this is true.
Yeah, I mean, the drawback that I was mentioning is just how broadly it can be applied to general system. So yes, if you already have a system that satisfies that, or that has a slightly more complicated thing with f of t and x plus p times or plus g of p, for example, you just redefine g of p as p prime and you come back to that. But yeah, there are still some system where you cannot apply that because of this restriction.
Yeah, yes, from that point of view, you're right. But I think there's a really very large number of practical systems and yes, let's say control engineering that fit into this formulation. Okay, do we have further questions? It doesn't seem to be the case. Then thanks again, Pierre-Jean, for your interesting presentation, for answering all the questions. And yes, it's just now time to say goodbye, to wish you a nice Friday afternoon, Friday evening, nice weekend. And yes, see you all again soon in 2 weeks. And in 2 weeks, there will be the next seminar.